you see how the Japanese manufacturing activities get muscle and start learning. And if anybody has any qualms or any undue admiration for the Japanese marketeership, and don't make any mistakes, I'm a great admirer of Japan. I like the country very much, and I have many friends there, and I fight them like hell every day. Now, in the beginning, there was no Japanese marketeering. In the first 10 years, no Japanese product was sold in this country under a Japanese brand. It was all sold under American brands, under the wrong impression that as long as you made a good bottom line for the next quarter, and as long as you get hold of your bonus at the end of the year, life was hunky-dory. Everything was just gorgeous. Now leave that stuff for the Japanese to make cheaply, you can cash in. And that's what happened. And that's how our American colleagues handed the huge American market to the Japanese industry on a platter. We always called that the Trojan horse was not only let in, it was pulled in. I exaggerate, but I have not much time. And that is... and I'm not lying to you, because that's the way it happened. And that is how the Japanese industry came to dispose of a 500 million people marketplace. And don't make any mistakes. The first video recorders, which were invented by Philips, as a matter of fact, were sold by the Japanese industry in the United States, not in Japan. First in the US. Because what you could sell in Denver, Colorado, you can sell in Osaka. And the norms are the same, and the standards are the same. And the size is, in principle, there. And you have to give it to our Japanese friends. They've taken full advantage of what chances were offered to them. The U.S., in fact, represents 50% of the world market in our disciplines. Now, any competitor who is strong here gains muscle by being in the United States. The market is big, it is a rich market, and it's a technically very advanced market. High technology comes from the United States. Well, not in concept, but in practice. So, and if you're not there, you'll see what happens. Microwave ovens, another thing that we invented way back. Lytton starts, the Japanese take it over, they dominate the United States and try to roll over Europe next. So you must be aware as a company, what happens there is going to come to you sometime. You better get ready either to defend yourself, which is very difficult on a regional market, or go there and fight it out with them in the arena. Be able to retaliate. It's very important that you have strength in your competitor's marketplace. So we need, and are going to get, and already have in part, strong presence in the United States. We don't mind competing with anyone. We like to play the game, but we like one set of rules, okay? Not you, free market in my country alone, and I not in yours. You keep me out. Japan keeps you out. Korea keeps you out. They should be penalized. Otherwise, they should not be let in here, because Japan, I think it's the only country in the world that has a decent industrial policy. All noses point to the same direction. Government, banking, politics, labor unions, industry. They all want one thing. They want Japan to win, which is a sort of an old-fashioned, primitive, nationalistic feeling that we used to have way back. But they still have it. We did not change the national organization structure. The world did. So we came to one dogma. We said, look, the product divisions have to define what the product is going to be. Just like Akio Morita does. He hasn't got 65 country managers to listen to what his TV set's going to look like. Trinitron is Trinitron is Trinitron, like Henry Ford said, any color, as long as they're all black. So when we now see how those global products invade Europe, when we're still in a mixture of 12, 16 different countries with small size factors, we've got to move in a hurry. And the national organizations who used to have of the whole chain from beginning of the product till the payment by the customer, they used to have this chunk. Now they're going to have a chunk which is much smaller, which is the marketing side, and which is perhaps the feedback from the marketplace, if any such feedback takes place, and the rest should be the division. Now, the main point is you cannot tilt matrices. You put it aside or you handle it. There's no other way. And it's been nice saying so. So we had product divisions that were worldwide responsible for their bottom line, and we had countries that were responsible for their bottom line. Ladies and gentlemen, that doesn't work. I think the question was justified when I took over to say, gentlemen, are we going on another 40 years with the same organization, or should we change? So we sat down and talked, improving rentability, or improving profits. And what's important? Important is what we're good at. And we say we're good at technology, and I think we have the, I challenge anybody to say different, but we have perhaps the most deeply, capillarily penetrated marketing organization in the world. These two strengths we have to fully use and fully exploit to get where we want to be. And we want to remain in the forefront of some basic core businesses, and we defined those. You talked the whole day, and no one was in agreement because everybody defended his own fiefdom. Nobody wanted to let go of what he was responsible for. So we said, either we come to a conclusion 4 o'clock in the second day, or I will have one more meeting with the whole top staff in Philips, and I'll resign. And I'll tell them, this board is not capable of setting its own priorities. We have no strategy. You pick yourself a new president, I'm going to leave. This cannot be going on like that, because in our company, we talked a lot, and everything always stayed the same. Consensus, conviction, metrics, all that kind of thing. But the world had changed, so we had to make it quite clear that unless we command the sails to be hoisted, the ship won't move. But normally, people don't like change. You don't like change, okay? As much as you like it, as much as you talk about it, you pay lip service. You hate it when someone comes in and says, look, we're going to throw your department around. Stand up and let me see. What do you do? You say, what are you doing here? I'm doing a fine job. Go away. We don't want change. So the change is not so easy to effect. We all had those profit centers in the countries. It was not so important that you did not get the first line feedback from the marketplace quickly, neither in the electronics industry nor in the automobile industry. A product changed every 3 years or so. So it was slow and not always very effective. Today, the marketplace moves quickly. An audio product changes every year, every 8 months, and it used to be, as I say, 2 or 3 years. So now that we have product divisions directing immediately what happens in the countries. And in the big countries, those product division leaders there are sitting on the board of the big product divisions. We think the interaction becomes much more vital. They will hear what it is all about. They will see the headaches and the troubles, and they can immediately, or at least a lot faster, interact. And the president of such a division gets authority over the budget of the research division. Until now, it was sort of have a subscription to a club. You pay, and if anything comes out, okay. We say, free research we will maintain, like Bell has done, like RCA always did, but we will have 80% of everything you guys spend subject to the manager's decision. Why must that money be spent this way? And it's all in all over 2-3 billion guilders, so we think that should squeeze this thing much closer together.